And do I hear a motion to waive the reading of the December minutes? Do I hear a second? Do I hear a second? Okay. In the absence of Alice Rand and Ivan Most, who is going to be late, I would like to appoint Judith and Steve to vote. Okay? Thank you. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes? I have just a few that I'll go over quickly. On page 5, at the bottom of the page, the motion was seconded by Mr. Tinsman and voted 4-1 for approval. I think that it would be good if we put down who was opposed, and unfortunately that was me. I think it would just keep a better record of things. On page 14, the public was talking about roads, so I can understand how this happened. It said Mary Alice Road. I think it was Mary Alice Riley, R-E-I-L-L-E-Y, from the public, said. Let's see, where else? Oh, then on page 15, Mrs. Guthrie said that in calling the state park, she was just overwhelmed by the number of cars that use Two Lights Road for just the state park on a Sunday afternoon. I think that what I said was that has there ever been a car counter on Two Lights Road on a hot Sunday afternoon, because I did not get any facts regarding traffic on Sunday afternoons. And that was it. Any other additions or corrections to the minutes? Do I hear a motion to accept the minutes as amended? Is there a second to that?
Seconded.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay, next on the list, correspondence. I'll go as quickly as I can. An invitation to the expansion and dedication ceremonies at the Redeemer Lutheran Church on January 14th. I was unable to attend, but wished them well. A notice from Sally Tinsman, the chair of the Conservation Commission, regarding a meeting on January 11th at 7:30 p.m. with the tree warden and a representative of the Highlands. An issue of the Maine Townsman published by the Maine Municipal Association. A notice from the Portland Area Comprehensive Transportation Study, otherwise known as PACS, but since there's another PACS, I spelled that all out, of a transportation workshop on February 15th between 7:30 and 9 p.m. at the Jetport for anyone who is interested. I received two notices from COG regarding spring subdivision workshops at USM and a brochure on the 1990 sub-regional forums. On December 19th, a memo from Barbara, is it Barheit? Barheit, who is the senior planner from COG regarding monthly rental costs in mobile home parks. A quarterly planning newsletter from COG on January 14th, a letter from Michael and Antoinette, I think it is Melhan, but it was difficult to read the signature, but we will correct that if we are incorrect. They are opposing the Highlands subdivision, and they also oppose a permanent access road from Broad Cove to Two Lights, and citing four reasons for their opposition. Mr. and Mrs. Melhan reside at 69 Two Lights Road. A letter dated January 12th from Leland Murray, who is our deputy fire chief, regarding the need for a full access road from Broad Cove to Two Lights Road because of water main extension and the positive aspects of that and the potential for blockage of the roads by trees. Okay, that's it on correspondence. Next, under old business, last time, the planning board had just cause to extend the public hearing regarding the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot major subdivision. So tonight, I would like to open up that public hearing once again, since I think approximately 8 people, we did not have time to hear their comments. The same rules apply. Please don't repeat yourself. I won't go into the long story that I went into last month, but please try not to repeat yourself, and please limit your comments to a few minutes. So with that, I will open the public hearing, and anyone from the public is welcome to come up, and we're very interested in hearing your comments. Yes.
Marion, while Mrs. Perry is on her way up, I would just like to state again for the record that I'm not participating. I'm just watching.
Okay. Judith, will you please vote?
Yes. Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Rachel Perry, and I live at 10 Pine Ridge Road.
Mrs. Perry, are you talking into the microphone? I can hear you, but perhaps the people in the back can't. Well, maybe it's the television equipment. Wait just a moment, Mrs. Perry, and we'll fix that. Because this is also being televised once again, and many people in the home audience are interested in these proceedings. Thanks, Steve. Okay, proceed.
Okay, we're on.
Why don't you repeat your name again so that people will know.
Okay, I'm Rachel Perry, and I live at 10 Pine Ridge Road. The Greater Portland Development Group is required in its subdivision application to state the impact its development will have on the goals and objectives of the comprehensive plan. The first goal of the comprehensive plan is to preserve Cape Elizabeth's remaining rural character by protecting scenic areas, by preserving significant open space, and by directing growth to areas best suited for development and away from marginal and undevelopable land. The Broad Cove Highlands proposal does none of these. The second goal of the comprehensive plan is the protection of our natural resources from incompatible development. An important natural resource is wetlands. To adequately protect wetlands, the scientific community is advocating 100 to 250-foot buffer zones. The Greater Portland Development Group's plan instead incorporates wetlands into house lots, almost assuring the encroachment and demise of those wetlands. Another important natural resource is wildlife habitats and wildlife travel corridors. Ecoanalyst, the developer's own wetlands and wildlife expert, has recommended that the apple trees be left and pruned since they are a deer feeding ground, and that the existing vegetation be left between building lots to provide for wildlife corridors. The Broad Cove Highlands proposal does not provide for these recommendations. Also recommended by Ecoanalyst is that the wetlands be completely protected as a wildlife habitat. Development at the edge of a wetlands negatively impacts that outer edge of wetlands. It negatively impacts the travel corridor around the wetlands, and it drives the wildlife to either encroach on homestead vegetation, or it drives the wildlife to the core of the wetlands, therefore greatly diminishing the size and value of the wildlife habitat. I would like to mention that our state's concern for wetlands was initiated because of concern for waterfowl habitat. Since 1953, there has been a 50% decrease in waterfowl on the Atlantic seaboard due to loss of wetlands habitat. Two other objectives under the goal of protecting natural resources are expanding the greenbelt system and increasing public access to our town's existing trails. There are several existing trails in Broad Cove Highlands and several access points to those trails that have been used for years that are being eliminated, that are not being incorporated into the overall Broad Cove Highlands plan. The third goal of the comprehensive plan is to provide quality community services and facilities that will meet the needs of the town. An objective under this goal is encouraging proper siting of septic systems. Septic systems eventually fail on marginal soils. I question, at whose expense will these septic systems be replaced? Will the town foot the bill for another expensive sewer system? Problems and restrictions associated with marginal soils should be avoided. Developments initially should be planned appropriately. The last objective I am citing from the comprehensive plan is to provide an adequate level of recreational facilities and services at the neighborhood level. The town's comprehensive plan cites Broad Cove as having an open space deficiency, and it recommends that Broad Cove be targeted for the creation of a future park and open space area. We're at that last crossroad for Broad Cove. The planning board should make sure the open space recommendation, as well as all recommendations of the town's goals, are met. The planning board, using its discretionary authority, should also require that open space be usable for recreation. We use the cliffs for sliding. We use the frog ponds. We use the trails. The state site location of development law, in an attempt to preserve areas like Broad Cove Highlands, requires that there be no adverse effect on the natural environment. Quote, the developer has made adequate provision for fitting the development harmoniously into the existing natural environment, and that the development will not adversely affect existing uses, scenic character, or natural resources in the municipality, unquote. To summarize, the scenic value of the land should be preserved, usable open space should be dedicated, an adequate trail system established, and wetlands and wildlife habitats protected. Since the current Broad Cove Highlands plan does not adequately meet these goals, I urge the Planning Board to reject Greater Portland Development Group's current proposal. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Perry. Anyone else from the public wishing to address this?
Just walked in and they put me on the hot seat here right away.
Well, I hope that you've caught your breath.
I'm Bill DeAngelo. I live at 75 Hunts Point Road. I think at the last meeting, what my wife presented to all of you in black and white and in color, namely a photograph or a picture of the straightaway, you're now going to hear about in stereo from me. I'm a physician, and my specialty lends itself, unfortunately, to taking care of lots of trauma cases. Now,
trauma cases.
And I'm not a traffic engineer, but I can tell you after 11 years of experience in this field that there are certain things that I can pick up on that lead to higher incidence of accidents and trauma. And this is not only for vehicular accidents, but also for pedestrian trauma. And I can tell you, unfortunately, a lot of my pedestrian cases come from busy roads, especially busy straight thoroughfares. When I first moved to the Cape Elizabeth community, I used to live on 9 Trundy Road, which was right at the mouth, so to speak, of the Shore Acres development. And it became readily apparent to me early on that that wasn't a great location, especially for a family with young children. And it was through a fair amount of effort that we finally located what I thought was an ideal spot on a cul-de-sac. Now, I was never crazy about Hunts Point Road to begin with, but to compound the error of living on a straightaway by living on a straight throughway, in my mind, would just be beyond belief, really. I think the board has an obligation, certainly, to treat Mr. Kennedy fairly in their proceedings, but I think the board also has a very strong obligation to treat the residents of the Hunts Point Road extension fairly, and realizing that it's going to be, I think, a very serious impact, adverse impact on our section of the community there. Now, I don't have a real good solution for the board for the emergency access problem, and I really don't. I think that's going to have to be worked out some way or another. But I don't favor at all having Hunts Point Road made into a 1-mile straightaway. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Has anyone else? Do you have something? Didn't you speak last time?
Could I speak on a different topic tonight?
Sure. If you have something different, you are most welcome.
Thank you. I wanted just to say a few words about the proposed connector between Hunts Point Road and Two Lights Road.
Yes, I know that you are Dr. Sullivan.
Yes, I am.
But maybe
Richard Red Sullivan. Thank
okay.
you. We heard last week Mr. McGovern chronicle the history of the official thinking about the problems with the lack of second access in Broad Cove and how the town officials have traditionally thought of a connection between Hunts Point and Two Lights Road as a solution to this problem. And they have seen this as a free and an easy solution to this dilemma. But I'd like to point out that this is not a free road and it's not an easy solution. In order for this free road to come into being, the town requires the builder to shoulder this burden in figuring his costs in developing the land. And Mr. Kennedy, as a result of adding this road to his project, has had to double the number of lots from 11 to 22. And in doing so, he has been forced to proceed with a level of development which, in our opinion, this land just can't afford to take. We can recognize this area as ecologically marginal for development. And we have, with our experts, shown that 10 out of the 22 lots proposed will not meet the state DEP standard for subsurface wastewater disposal. And so therefore, this road comes, in my opinion, at a very high price. And it's the price of trying to force a level of development which is not appropriate. And it's, in a sense, putting the town officials in the paradoxical position of, on one hand, through the comprehensive plan, saying that, recommending that development be discouraged in environmentally marginal areas, and on the other hand, telling this developer that he has to force a 22-lot development in this area. So this is not a free road. This is a road which will extract a very high price in terms of ecologic damage to this land. And it will also extract a very high price in terms of transformation of existing neighborhoods into something entirely different. So the neighbors are going to pay a very high price for this road by having a dead-end road become a thoroughfare. And the residents of Two Lights Road are paying a high price for the road by having their rural neighborhood become an annex of a subdivision. And I'm reminded of another project which the town has sponsored, namely the Sawyer Road, Fickett Road project, in which, in the name of providing a new east-west thoroughfare and corridor, the residents of that neighborhood saw their quiet country road turn into a textbook suburban street, which looks like it should end up in the main mall. And we residents of our neighborhood don't want to have our neighborhood transformed by roads which serve some theoretical safety purpose. I think when we see the price that this road will extract, both from the neighborhood and from the land, that we should perhaps go back and look at other alternatives to solving this problem. This was seen as a free and easy solution, so other alternatives really have not been adequately explored. For example, if the connection between Broad Cove and Shore Acres could be established, Although this would not completely solve the cul-de-sac problem, it would partially solve two big cul-de-sac problems, Shore Acres having more than 100 houses. Perhaps there could be a connection through Phase 2 connecting Hunts Point Road with Channel View Road. If we had a combination of a connection through here and a connection out here, there would be only a short stretch of road in which a derailment or a tree down would lead to an inability to get out of the neighborhood. And so I think that perhaps a combination of several different approaches could be used to solve the same problem. But I think whatever solution is decided, I think the planning board needs to realize that road, which is seen as an easy and free solution to the problem, is not free, and it's not an easy solution. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sullivan. Anyone else from the public? Yes. Are you speaking on a different topic this time, too?
I understand that Mrs. Brand, Madam Chairman, had some questions.
Oh, indeed she did.
And I'm here primarily to answer those.
Oh, thank you. Alice?
What?
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Could you please tell the public who you are?
Natalie Stoddard, 3 Running Tide Road.
Thank you for coming back, Mrs. Stoddard. Alice, what were your questions?
Well, one of my questions was, I believe you stated last time that perhaps there were nesting ducks on the pond. Is that correct?
That is correct. There are...
Black ducks?
Black duck and mallard. And they are in the pond on Phase 1. Here, mm-hmm. And as well at this pond up here. In the spring, when the wetlands are inundated in this lowland area along this edge of Phase 1, I've seen them there too.
Thank you. And then my other question was in reference to the orchids, which were, I guess, described by you as being an endangered species. Could you identify those?
There are threatened species and endangered species. This orchid is threatened. Endangered species are those which it is thoroughly against the law to disturb. This particular orchid is, its common name is Lady's Tresses. It is a short-branched orchid with tiny white flowers which circumnavigate the stem, and it's very sweetly scented. It grows about 6 inches high. Its location is from shortly after the rise goes up here, from here to the bifurcation of the road. It's about 25 yards, I would say. It occurs on both sides of the road along with fringed gentian, mm-hmm. which I haven't seen.
We did see the remnants of those on a sidewalk.
Yeah. The orchids are in amongst them.
And are the? Did you classify those orchids as endangered or threatened?
Along the old road, was it?
Along Farm Pond Road, from about 20 yards from Running Tide Road, up to where the road splits. There are some right in that corner, and as well on both sides of this dirt road.
Thank you, Mrs. Stoddard. Any other questions?
Well, I would like to recommend to the town that whatever wetlands survey is undertaken, that in addition, the town ask the state botanist to come down and go over the proposed subdivision in its entirety. There may be other things found there. For example, the botanist, when she came down to identify the orchid for me, suggested that I look along the pond edges of the nearby pond for sedges and grasses which might be amongst the threatened or endangered species. Unfortunately, I'm one of those pseudo-botanists who knows nothing about grasses.
I wish I knew as much as you knew about grasses.
I would like to add briefly that in addition to the ducks, we have using those ponds herons. There is a red-shouldered hawk that I've seen for several years which hunts along the hedgerows on the edges in here. We have quail and pheasant and woodcock in that area. Woodcock doesn't like to be disturbed, and there are not that many of them available anymore. In addition to the foxes, I have seen a mink in that area. And aside from requesting that the state botanist be brought in to examine the entire area, unless you have further questions, that's all I have to add.
Well, thank you. Anyone with further questions? Well, we thank you again, Mrs. Stoddard. Anyone else? Yes.
My name is Christine Pettinger, and I live at 42 Hunts Point Road, and I have two very quick points. The first is the traffic on Hunts Point Road. I speak as a mother and as a nurse.
A mother and a nurse?
Yes. I am very concerned, as Dr. D'Angelo is, about the traffic that we already have on that road. And I ask the board to strongly look at the traffic patterns throughout this whole new phase in Broad Cove. Also, I vehemently urge you to look into the wetlands. We have a pond in our backyard and many, many beautiful trees that have been drowned in the 3 years that we have lived there. So I really ask you to look into the wetland and all its issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Pettinger. Anyone else? Yes.
My name is Chet Crum. I live at 1 Running Tide Road, which is just right off this area here. And I, like Natalie, have walked this area for about the past 6 years. And I guess the key issue that I want to urge you to look into is the wetlands issue. One of the reasons I moved into 1 Running Tide was because we were on a sewer system. And if you look at our lot there, which is about an acre, and we adjoin Natalie's area, in the springtime it's nothing but a river in the backyard. And there's several times in the summer when it's my lawnmower buries up to the wheels and you can't get through that area. So this whole area, all through that area, has a lot of water. There's a lot of wildlife. But the key issue is it's just there's water, too much water all up through that whole area.
Thank you, Mr. Crum. Yes, we seem to have the two distinguished chiefs with us this
evening. Thank you very much. Madam Chairman, members of the board, my name is David Pickering. I live at 7 Barry Beach Road, but I'm speaking to you this evening as your chief of police. During the last public hearing on this project, I sat at home and watched the process on our community access channel, as it was not originally my intent to participate in the public debate on the Highlands at Broad Cove. I have no particular feelings whether or not this development should be approved, and my position regarding the need for second access has by now been made quite clear, either by my written reports through the chair or in testimony before this board as a whole. However, after watching a number of residents make comments regarding the issue of traffic last month, I felt compelled to come here this evening and offer the following facts and statistics regarding traffic issues in Broad Cove. First, I'd like to say that in 1985, I established a program that we call the Selective Traffic Enforcement and Speed Survey. Through this program, I record and catalog each formal traffic complaint or any other issue that comes to my office directly through the complaint of any citizen that feels compelled to bring it to my attention. Upon receiving any complaint of habitually speeding vehicles along any street or roadway, I assign a number of officers to establish speed checks on the street in proximity to the location that was the source of the complaint. Since 1985, when this program went into effect, my office has received a total of 3 such complaints from all of Broad Cove. The first was October 23, 1986, by a resident of Pine Ridge Road. Our officers monitored this street and those adjacent to it at different times of the day and night, and recorded the average vehicle speed as 20.17 miles per hour. This notably was in a posted 25 mile per hour zone. The second complaint was from a resident of Broad Cove Road. My records indicate that we began selective enforcement activity on November 14, 1986. After accumulating several days of speed data, we calculated that the average vehicle speed in this area was 28.3 miles per hour. This is also in a 25 miles per hour zone. The last complaint that my office received from the Broad Cove subdivision was also from a resident of Broad Cove. In response to this complaint, we began our enforcement program on June 14, 1988. The results of this effort suggested that the average vehicle speed during this period was 30.06 miles per hour for the posted 25 mile per hour zone. I have never received any complaint regarding habitually speeding vehicles anywhere on Hunts Point Road, Winding Way, Salt Spray Lane, Ledgewood Lane, or any other side street or secondary road in the Broad Cove development since this speed enforcement program was begun in 1985. The last complaint that I personally received from any location in Broad Cove was over a year and a half ago, until last month's public hearing. After watching that, I advised our clerk to lay in a fresh supply of warnings and summonses, as it appeared that those guys from out of town were vehicularly terrorizing one of the finer neighborhoods in our community. I then ordered my officers to concentrate speed enforcement activity in the areas of Hunts Point and Broad Cove Roads. Our methodology was as it always had been. Over a period of time, a variety of officers would monitor speed in different locations using two different models of calibrated Doppler radar sets at various times of the day and night to monitor and log speeds of every vehicle it passes so that this information could be entered into our computer for later analysis. I cannot think of a more accurate way to determine actual vehicle speeds than the program that I just described. During this latest speed survey, a total of 9 different officers were assigned to random times of the day and evening beginning on December 27, 1989, and continuing at random through and including January 13, 1990. During this period, the officers recorded speeds of over 490 vehicles along Broad Cove and Hunts Point Roads. We stopped and warned all motorists who were traveling beyond what the state DOT considers to be unacceptable noncompliance, or acceptable noncompliance, that being 10 miles over the posted speed limit. We summonsed any motorist operating beyond 14 miles over the posted speed limit. For the period, the average speed of vehicles traveling along Broad Cove Road was 29.9 miles per hour. This is 4.9 miles per hour over the posted speed limit, but 5.1 miles per hour under the average speed that is considered to be unacceptable noncompliance by state DOT standards for a residential area. The highest speed recorded on Broad Cove Road was 48 miles per hour. The slowest was 16. During this period, the average speed of vehicles traveling on Hunts Point Road was 26.5 miles per hour, 1.5 miles per hour over the posted limit, but 8.5 miles per hour under the speed that is considered to be unacceptable noncompliance under state DOT standards. The highest speed recorded along Hunts Point Road was 36 miles per hour. The slowest was 17 miles per hour. A total of 11 speeding summonses were issued during the survey period. This translates to less than 3.5% of all vehicles surveyed traveling at speeds significant enough to warrant a summons. Interestingly, of those 11 motorists that were summoned, 9, or 82%, were residents of Broad Cove. Upon analysis of this data, the following conclusions regarding the contemporary traffic issues in Broad Cove may be reached. Number one, that heretofore, and after considering the significant traffic volumes, that there is a relatively low incident of formal complaints regarding habitually speeding vehicles in the Broad Cove subdivision. Two, that previous speed surveys have not demonstrated a remarkable pattern of vehicles being operated beyond acceptable noncompliance limitations. Three, that the roadway that accepts the highest traffic volumes is the one that is most susceptible to speeding vehicles. Four, that Hunts Point Road shows little, if any, evidence of habitually speeding vehicles. Five, that average vehicle speeds that have recently been monitored and recorded are well within the limits of acceptable noncompliance established by the state DOT and through our experience of developing speeding cases that have a reasonable chance for successful prosecution. And finally, that over 80% of the speeding violations in Broad Cove are being committed by those individuals who should be most aware of any real or imagined road character deficiency, density issue, or traffic-related problem inherent to the neighborhood. I would conclude by giving my assurances to this board, to the community at large, and to Broad Cove in particular, that should this subdivision be approved, the full-time secondary access road, that I will pledge any resource at my disposal to ensure compliance with the law and to ensure its safety to the residents of this neighborhood. If any member of the board has any questions, I'll attempt to answer them at this time.
Anyone with any questions? Ivan?
Yes, Chief. Will that report be available for our record?
Certainly.
Anyone else? I have a question. You know, if you can't answer this now, perhaps by the next time, because I know it's difficult to get accident statistics, but relative to not the intersection of Two Lights Road and Route 77, but that blind curve before you get to the intersection adjacent to the church where the driveways come out, et cetera.
Right.
What has the accident history been on that? I know that you can't give me statistics from
years.
Yeah,
I can't give you numbers at this point, but
yeah. In
my recollection, it's not significant, or it doesn't stand out in my mind as being an area that has to be redesigned or one that we would forward to DOT as an area for consideration.
Has there ever been a traffic count done in the summertime on Two Lights Road? Because, you know, the state park attracts 20,000 people during the summer.
I wouldn't be surprised if there had been. I think Director Bob Malley, Director of Public Works, would be the one that would have that information. He has access to the traffic counter.
Right.
I'm not aware specifically of one that was done, but I wouldn't be surprised if that information is available.
Right. Well, you know, I asked the applicant when Mr. Bray was here the last time, and perhaps he has that information at this time, since we asked him the last time. And then I think there was another thing that was brought out by the public. It seems that there's a section of Two Lights Road that gets swamped. You know, I guess this is Mr. Malley's area, but is it necessary to take police down there? How often does that happen? If you don't have the answers now, perhaps we
don't.
We could
the
know.
Police don't get direct involvement from that. Again, that road is actually maintained by DOT, and when that road floods, DOT are the people that we call, and they come out and put sawhorses around it. How often that happens, really tough to predict. If we had a significant rainfall right now, it would flood because there isn't any opportunity for runoff, and you know the ground certainly won't accept water this time of year.
Right.
But to say how many times it would happen, I would say it's more likely to happen during the time of year when there isn't significant traffic volumes on that road due to tourism, et cetera, being the winter months.
Right.
Or spring.
Thank you. And then a Mr. Henry Barry, I'm trying to remember all of this stuff.
I vaguely recall him.
Mr. Henry, if you watched, brought out the fact that it became so congested down where Two Lights Road dead ends, because that is essentially a very large dead end itself once you pass Fessenden, is it? Or
right.
Fessenden Road. But how often does that occur? Where you get that
again,
kind of
congestion. That's
congestion.
Kind of unpredictable. Generally, if there is a big storm or something that makes the surf attractive, that's when that becomes a problem. I always know because I get a lot of letters to the editors about us trying to keep people away from it because they want to drag their three-year-old down to see the pretty waves.
Right.
So I remember that.
I was concerned about that because essentially that entire area after Fessenden is an enormous dead end in itself.
Yes, it is.
Which makes the people of Broad Cove know that they aren't the only ones living in a dead end. I think that there are dead ends in all over the coast, east and west, probably all over the world, which you can attribute to just the water creating dead ends. But, you know, I was concerned about addressing emergency situations in this massive.
Yeah, as I recall, the problems or the enforcement problems down there have not been quite so bad as they once were. For instance, when the Monhegan Island races came by close to Two Lights, we'd get an extremely large number of people that came down to watch that, and that would be a problem down at the Lobster Shack parking lot in that area there. The last few years, it hasn't been as bad for whatever reason.
Well, you know, I'm only asking this question because we've got this, you know, this question of the access road is just one small part all of the enormity of this. And we do have ordinances, and when roads are created, they just can't be plunked you know. Mm-hmm. I think you have to look at all of the areas, and that's why we were asking the questions, so, you know, and to, certainly we don't want to exacerbate any safety problems elsewhere. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Well, thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Chief Webster, did you want to say a few words?
Chief Webster, Chief of the Fire Department.
Welcome.
Thank you. My comments are strictly from a public safety standpoint. We've got a lot of concerns. We've had a lot of concerns over the years. I know everybody on the board, the residents are familiar with the history. But I'd like to just bring out a couple of recent events that happened in the past year down there. On May 4th, we had a structure fire, 54 Hunts Point Road. We had the road tied up for four hours. We had no choice. We had a lot of complaints. We had people out there taking pictures even. They had a hair appointment, they had a doctor's appointment, you know, things of that nature. About the 1st of December, the water main at the construction site on Broad Cove was broken, along with the sewer at the same time. That whole area was without a drop of water for 4 hours, from 9 till 1. If we'd ever had a fire in there, we'd have been out of luck. And the other day I took, and I measured the distance from the front of the fire station to Dr. Holt's driveway, just using that as a destination. And it's a half a mile longer for us using Broad Cove Road than it would be going down Two Lights. Along with that, there are 5 90-degree turns we have to make going in there. So time is really a factor, along with the mileage. But as chief, I would just like to state for the record that for the above reasons, and also for that water main, that 8-inch water main coming in off Two Lights Road, which will enhance the fire protection in that area, we fully support the second means of access, believe me.
Full access. That's what I thought you'd say, Chief.
Well, I didn't disappoint you anyway.
Could we ask, does anyone want to, it's so nice to have our chiefs here at the meeting that people might have a few questions.
Chief Webster, I'm more, one of those things, that, of course, it seems so obvious from your perspective of getting your equipment to a fire, but I never really had thought until I was involved in this about the problem with the water. And that brings me to your, of course, you'd prefer a full access, but even if there were a limited access, we'd still be able to maintain or to install the, for lack of a better word, the better water system, so you'll have water no matter what, no matter where it gets turned off, right?
It's a grid. It would create a grid system down there where, in that construction project, they could have shut the water off at Ledgewood and fed it from Two Lights Road. So you would have been without water for a relatively short period while they just opened and closed a couple of valves, that's all.
But using a limited access road vis-a-vis a full access road coming in from Two Lights, you could still establish the water main system, couldn't you?
Oh, yes, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I believe that'll, no matter
happen
what,
anyway.
That'll be there.
I think that's probably.
But we would prefer the full access.
Okay.
Got one question, Madam Chair?
Yes, go ahead.
Chief Webster, are there any places in town, I know we've heard that limited access roads have gotten a bad rap in town because they're not available. Are there any places in town where you can cite that a limited access road has worked for fire protection equipment?
Not really. We find most of the limited access roads are used for storing their wood, packing their boat, and that's if we can get them to plow it.
So you pretty much have to cross them off the list?
Pretty much so, especially in the wintertime. We do try and chase around and get them to keep them open for us, but being a private development, most of them we find it pretty difficult.
You know, Chief, that really worries me. You know, I can understand. I think that all of our public safety people have, just in this particular application have certainly helped to raise the public's consciousness about safety issues. But I still have to wonder, you know, I mean, there are fire hydrants, and it's a universal thing that people know that you don't park in front of them. And it's overwhelming to me that the planning board in past years and your department has spent so much time creating these emergency accesses. I mean, don't we have any laws to prevent people from parking their boats there and their cars? And, you know, I can understand, I think the gates are quite bad in that during the winter they get iced up and snow gets pushed. But it is just overwhelming to me that cars can be parked there. Don't we have any laws that we can enforce?
Well, when the development is built, it's always put on the, I assume from you people that the road will be kept open. But I don't know, being a private road in a private development, we can ask them, and usually they'll cooperate.
Mm-hmm.
But the next storm, you're back down there again. And then it's a matter of getting them to move their boat or...
It's not the purview of this board, but I just feel that if we're going to create these things in the future as a planning board, you know, I think that we've got to, somebody's got to make them work. And I don't know, the planning board can't do that. It seems that what I have heard in recent weeks is that for emergency access, there can be no compromises because the open roads, we have been told, don't work, and the closed roads don't work. So obviously, it's an all-or-nothing situation.
That's right. If it's a
that's what we're
if
hearing.
It's a full road, then you don't have the problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else? Okay. Anyone else from the public? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Susan Scanlon, and I live on Two Lights Road. My concern is the further potential deterioration of air quality in the Two Lights area. I've noticed during the summer that the air isn't very good, and I thought maybe an additional few cars would be negligible, the amount of emissions from a few more cars. So I called the Department of Environmental Protection today, and I talked to the woman who's responsible for the monitoring of the air quality at Two Lights, and she said that the ozone level at Two Lights is worse than any place else in the state of Maine except Kennebunk, but it ties with Kennebunk for being the worst. It's worse than it is in the city of Portland, it's worse than it is on the Turnpike, and it's because of the peculiarity of the location of the Two Lights area of Cape Elizabeth that we receive a lot of ozone. She called it a pluming effect from Boston when there's a southwest wind and so forth, and also from the local auto emissions. And I asked her if she thought that additional traffic would make the problem worse, and she said, in fact, additional traffic would cause what they call a scrubbing effect with the ozone, which is a very volatile molecule, and that it would reduce the ozone because the auto emissions would combine with the extra oxygen atom in the ozone and create other kinds of chemical effects in the air. She said she couldn't be absolutely sure what type of chemicals we'd end up breathing as a result of the addition of more traffic, but it would definitely make the air quality problem worse. And I'm not trying to create a problem where one doesn't exist. You have to realize that in the Two Lights area specifically, exclusively throughout the state of Maine, there already is a severe air quality problem. And so all I'm saying is I'm trying to ask you to take into consideration, to take the air quality in an already endangered place into consideration if you're thinking of bringing more traffic into that area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Scanlon. Anyone else from the public wishing to speak? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Lynn Lovett, and I live at 31 Broad Cove Road. And I didn't realize that Chief Pickering was going to be here tonight, but it's been very obvious to me, I live just after Dead Man's Curve on Broad Cove Road, that the increased police vigilance has been appreciated by me. Several of my friends have been nailed in the last week, going 40 miles an hour. I, too, was stopped, but that's because my headlight was out. I just want to pick up where Sylvia Kostopoulos left off at the last meeting. We really need to do something about the traffic pressure on Broad Cove Road, the speed on Broad Cove Road. I can't believe the speeds that Chief Pickering was citing, but he's got the gun, so... the speed gun, I mean. So anyway, I just know that I have followed several people who, after I've proceeded down the road at 25 miles an hour, will pull out behind me, lean on their horn after I've turned into my driveway, and shoot up the road at least 40 miles an hour. And I just pull out of my driveway and follow them home. They're usually kids, and have a word or two with them, or call their parents or whatever. I don't call the police anymore.
You just make citizen arrests.
Well, I just, you know, I think that if people know that I'm sure I'm known as the witch of the neighborhood at this point, but I really am concerned. We've lost a dog in front of the Higgins house because of speed and because the dumb dog ran out in the road, but I'm just afraid it's going to be a child. A neighbor runs along Broad Cove Road every morning at 7:30 in traffic, and I keep thinking she's on the wrong side of the road because she's on that curve, and she's going to, you know, she slipped on the ice. The road is narrow. The traffic is there. Someone's really going to get hurt. My other issue is I love the Coops. I love the Highlands area. We enjoy watching the Fox Den in the spring. I enjoy watching the birds and the ducks. I was dive-bombed by a heron one day walking through there. It's a beautiful area, and I hate to see it disturbed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Lovett. Anyone else from the public? Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Lynn Johnston. I'm an abutter to the project. I live on 71 Hunts Point Road. I'm sorry I missed the early part of the meeting, but I just wanted to make my problems and issues known. One, I have three children. I live on Hunts Point Road. I'm very concerned about the safety issues. I know you've heard a lot of that. Two, obviously, the traffic will have a significant impact on the safety of our children on 70 on Hunts Point Road, period. That'll be a pretty sizable increase in traffic going out that way, and I think we all recognize that. Three, I don't believe there are any technical reasons why that road, if it has to go in at all, couldn't go through to Farm Pond Road other than dollars for the additional road, which are probably not as substantial as what the value impact might be on the developer's lots. So, one, I guess what we're saying is we're trading off some of our property value to save the developer, one, his property value and the cost of the road. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public wishing to speak? Yes. Hi.
Hi. My name is Don Barrett. I live at 25 Hunts Point. I have three points I'd like to make. Number one, it seems to me there's a certain security advantage by having a single entrance into the neighborhood. And I think that should be considered along with some of the other public safety issues. Number two, if we need another entrance, it seems to me it ought to be a limited access. And although I've heard a lot of problems about limited access roads, I know the town manager mentioned last meeting that the Farm Pond Road was a limited access at one point. And I find that hard to believe because there's no signs there, it's never been maintained, and it seems to me there's been no effort to keep that as an emergency access. And it seems to me someone's been remiss if, in fact, that has been designated as a limited access road. And if you reject 1 and 2, if you find it necessary to put another entrance in, I don't see why you would put it at the end of Hunts Point. This is already a strip right now, and to put more traffic at one end of this strip, you know, irrespective of the statistics that were given, you know, they won't mean much to that parent someone that gets hit, because that's the only one person who is doing 48 miles an hour. And I think because this is a strip here, to add more at one end of it and giving someone the full length of this road would be a mistake. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Barrett. Anyone else from the public? Yes.
I'm George Higgins. I live on 40 Broad Cove Road. When we purchased our house, which was being built at the time, before that purchase, I came to this building and talked to the planners at that time, asking them about another access road. I was assured by people here, not this group, that that would be built and built soon. And there was no way to escape that. And I was assured that that would occur. And that was a major reason that I bought the house that we're in. Since that time, I have called a couple of times and have been reassured each time that that will occur.
Who are you calling, sir?
I've come to this building and I've gone to the upstairs office where I was directed. I can't recall the title of the people with whom I spoke, but they certainly were in a position to know what was going to happen. I respect all of the arguments from those on Hunts Point Road, but I have been living with those same concerns in actual reality for the last several years. I believe it is unsafe to have a single road into that development. I believe there should be a second, and I must tell you that I was reassured that this would become true certainly before this date, and I hope your deliberations lead to that conclusion.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Louise, do you have something new to say this week?
No, I just have a question to Chief Pickering.
I don't. I think the Chief Pickering has left the premises. Well, that is certainly something that we didn't ask you to come to the microphone, so now all of the people don't know who you are. You are Louise Sullivan of Two Lights Road, and Mrs. Sullivan would like some information from Chief Pickering on speeding on Two Lights Road. Is that correct? And perhaps we could have that addressed. Our planner will assist you with that. Anyone else from the public? Mr. Plum, you hold it before I recognize you. you spoke at length last time, and unless you have something new, you know, do you have anything new to say in the next 2 minutes? Because the applicant has been waiting very patiently to address all of this public comment, and I'd like to afford him the time to do that. So unless you have something absolutely new.
I have 2 comments on what has been said already.
Okay, then would you come up to the microphone? It isn't that you're not welcome, it's just that, you know, we're really anxious to hear from the applicant who has waited patiently now.
First, we have prepared a summary of our position for the Planning Board, which I would like to present to the Planning Board, which also contains our specific recommendations, which I won't repeat here because I've made them the other night,
and we have
to what course of action we recommend and ask the Planning Board to take. This is in relatively brief form, but we thought it might be helpful to the Board if
Thank
we put
you.
It all together.
Thank you.
Do that. On the subject of this road, about which you received an impassioned plea from Mr. McGovern last time, I think, as you yourself have pointed out, Mrs. Guthrie, that the chief, if I'm reading between the lines, please forgive me, that the town manager is losing the forest for the trees. The issue before this board is whether...
Oh, I don't think I said that.
Well, I said I was reading between the lines, and forgive me if I'm misreading. But the issue before this board is whether this project complies with your ordinance, not the circumstances under which the town gets a free road. And that troubles me mightily, because to have that impassioned plea from your town manager in the face of all the other issues that are confronting this planning board seems to me to be going a bit far. And I do sincerely hope that the manager, and I accept the disclaimers of the police chief and the fire chief, that they have no personal stake or stake in the outcome of this particular pending procedure before you. But so far as the position of a town is concerned in using a pending application to obtain an additional road at no cost to the town for whatever reason the town may want it, is certainly inappropriate. And we would ask the planning board to view it in the context of that observation, because what is before you is an application that must comply with a whole range of things. And the merits or demerits of this road, in whatever configuration the board may view it, really are only a secondary aspect of the application before you. And Dr. Sullivan was quite right that he said that the cost to the citizens of the area resulting from, and to Mr. Kennedy too, and he was quoted in the paper last night at some length about this, and we sympathize with him, that he feels himself very much under the gun in this whole thing to produce something that the town wants, which in turn makes him try to pound a square peg in a round hole. And that's what we think is really going on here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Plum. Anyone else from the public? Oh, you may come forward, but this was, I think that it would be better if you did. Why don't you come up and tell the people so they don't think that some hanky-panky is going on? Come on up and tell the people who you are and address this, okay? I was going to just, this is a Conservation Commission thing, but you might as well go on.
Thank you, Marion.
Go on.
My name is Jack Roberts, and I'm a member of the Conservation Commission. The commission met on January 11th, and we had a recommendation which has been forwarded to the planning board. I would like to read that into the record so that the public is also aware of our recommendation. The Conservation Commission unanimously recommends that the Broad Cove development, which has significant value and that public access is imperative, we recommend a 15-foot wide pedestrian easement along the southern edge of the northern wetland that would extend through the project to Two Lights Road. In addition to the easement, we'd recommend that the wetland area north of the pedestrian easement be deeded to the land trust if they are willing to receive it. Placement of the easement through the wetlands was considered unacceptable. It needs to be along the edge.
Thank you very Thank you. Much. And don't go away, because we'll probably get to this conservation easement again. Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Seeing no one, I will close the public hearing and ask the applicant if he would like to address any of the concerns, or do you have any statements that you wish to make?
Madam Chairman, members of the board, Paul Frinsco on behalf of the applicant. Can you hear me?
Well, if you could just speak up a little. My ears are going in my
Can you hear me
age.
Now?
Yes, thank okay. you.
Before I make a few comments, I'd just like to get a procedural matter resolved with the chair and the board members, if they could assist me. Throughout the course of this proceeding, we have heard references to materials which have been submitted to the board and not to the applicant. Is there some way, Madam Chairman, that you could require that any materials which are submitted to the board or to your planner as your staff member also be given to the applicant? It is very difficult to come to a hearing and find that the board has had it in possession for a week or so materials which we haven't seen and can't respond to.
Well, if you could just list all of those materials that you seem to have missing, I'm sure our planner would be delighted to see, you know, if they have been sent to you, et cetera. You know,
Madam
if
Chairman,
you could make a list.
I know how to get the materials after the fact. That's very simple. What I'm asking for, if you have any ability to request that they also be given to the applicant at the time they're given to the board through your staff. I can always get them after the fact. I know how to do that.
We'll ask. That's a procedure.
It would be very helpful to us.
We don't, you know, get involved. But
I should say Mr. Plum has been most courteous on behalf of his members in furnishing us with copies at the same time he gives them to you. That kind of courtesy from other persons would be greatly appreciated.
Okay.
To the comments, Madam Chairman. With respect to the wetlands, I'd like to tell the Planning Board that the representative of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers will be on site within the next 10 days to confirm the wetlands mapping done by echo analysts. And we will confer with you once we have their confirmation. Second, I believe that there's been an intimation to you through materials presented that you can't do wetlands mapping in the wintertime. That simply is incorrect. You may ask me how I know. I have engaged consultants who are quite acceptable and recognized by this planning board to conduct these kinds of wetland mapping during the past month and including January of 1990. Yes. Does it require more labor? Yes, it does. Is it more expensive? Yes, it is. Can it be done? Absolutely, and is presently ongoing. So I want you to understand that any suggestion that wetlands mapping must await May or June of 1990 simply is not correct. Finally,
just a question. It's expensive because you have to dig.
Please be careful. I don't want to represent myself as a wetlands. Let me just tell you what's been told to me. I am not. I know nothing about it.
Mm-hmm.
But those who engage in this say that additional laboratory work is required to identify species.
I see. Okay, thank you. I won't ask you any more about the wetlands.
I'm told that when plants aren't in bloom, it takes a little more analysis to determine what they are. You should note that the wetlands concerns with respect to this development in its present configuration are only with respect to the location of roads. You folks have pending before you a wetlands permit application to accommodate these matters. And I hope at some point in the proceedings we can get to the scheduling of a hearing on that application also to put this issue to rest. On the issue of sanitary waste, it has not only been intimated to you, but you have had representations made to you by two different people now that there is a requirement of the Department of Environmental Protection that there be a hydrogeologic analysis with a nitrogen nitrate analysis at the same time, and this will be required for this subdivision. I let this pass at the last hearing, knowing that I'd have an opportunity to discuss this with you afterwards. The Department of Environmental Regulations and the application form itself for site location approval require a hydrogeologic analysis only in those cases of subsurface waste disposal where, one, the project is located on a sand and gravel deposit and the project proposes on-site potable water supply from wells and or any of the lots are less than 80,000 square feet. The record before you demonstrates that none of those conditions are present with respect to this application. Second, the Cape Elizabeth land use regulations do not require such an analysis. You have before you in the record what is required to satisfy both state and local requirements for subsurface waste disposal, done by a certified professional acceptable to your community. Finally, on the issue of sanitary waste, the obvious alternate to this concern is the installation of public sewers. notwithstanding the fact that in the town of Cape Elizabeth, the capacity is available to treat the waste, and the sewers are accessible to this community and to this development, the town of Cape Elizabeth right now purports to be able to refuse the installation of public sewers to this development. If you'd like to cure that problem, I would urge you to make a recommendation to your town council that their present position is perhaps not in the best interest of the community. None of my business, but if that's what you want to see, you folks have at least the first step authority to deal with the issue of sanitary waste through the use of public sewers. I would hope at some time you might consider that. As you know, the discussions have been had with you in the past with respect to public sewers, and this particular applicant has indicated his willingness to install them. But if the town of Cape Elizabeth won't let him install them, we have a hurdle.
I'm afraid that we cannot help you with that. This board has no purview over sewers.
This board is the planning and land use consultant to the town council. I would hope they would listen to you. You may make recommendations to the town council. If you choose not to, I guess I can't deal with that. But if you think that's what's appropriate for this area, then I would urge you to make that recommendation. Third, a minor point, but in conjunction with this application, there is also a minor amendment to the Hunts Point subdivision. We proposed a solution to that technical concern back in late October, which a copy of which was submitted to the chair in early November. We have no response yet to that proposal. And I would only urge you, with respect to my suggested solution, it doesn't come out of thin air. If we refer to Section 16.2.5 of your own subdivision ordinance, which recommends and requires that amendments to a former plan make reference to the original recorded plan, my solution is exactly what your existing subdivision ordinance requires. I hope at some time we could get a response to that so we could clear up any questions about that.
Madam Chairman, just to respond, I just handed out, and I can give to the applicant a copy of a letter from the town attorney dealing with that issue, and it addresses it to some degree and states that perhaps a little more than what the applicant suggested previous to this night may need to be done. So I think that's something that the applicant's attorney, the town's attorney, and I can work on.
And that, just to satisfy your curiosity, is dated January 16th. That's today.
Someone must have known.
You are getting this information.
Someone must have known I was coming tonight.
At the same time.
I don't see myself copy, but I appreciate the copy. Oh, I see.
Right.
Okay.
It's
Someone must have found out very late I was coming tonight. Minor point. Fourth point. Fire Chief, in his analysis and response to concerns of the neighbors and concerns of the board, has indicated his concern and the problems he has had with certain types of limited access road. You will note in his testimony that his concerns relate, and he says so, solely to private limited access ways, which he feels, and probably quite correctly, the town has limited ability to enforce. You will recall that this applicant in the past has proposed to you a limited access road to be held by the public, i.e., the rights to which are with the town of Cape Elizabeth, which cures any question of enforcement. Basic policy questions about these will have to remain for local concern. But as to the enforcement aspects, we could certainly solve that by making it a public limited access road. Five, with respect to neighborhood concerns, immediately the next day after the last public hearing, December 19th, I extended an invitation to the neighbors through their council to sit down and try to work together to find a solution to their concerns in a manner which we could design a project that might meet the concerns of all, which may be an impossible task. The offer was extended. I've had no response. I will continue the offer because I think it's the way to resolve these kinds of concerns, especially where, and in summary, the applicant before you on at least two of the major issues is placed in the position that he is today because of direct governmental action of the town of Capelsburg. Number one, the sanitary waste concerns, and number two, the road concerns or the through street concerns. They are not products of this applicant. They do concern the neighbors greatly, and hopefully we can resolve these concerns together. We are available for questions. Mr. Kennedy has any comments he'd like to make at this time? Mr. Kennedy and his engineers are here with questions.
Madam Chairman?
Yes, I would like to ask the applicant to comment on the economics of going from an 11 lot to a 22 lot due to the implied imposition by the town that a full access road be built.
The 11 lot proposal last year was very limited roadways, private roads, no public water, and they were narrow private roads. The feeling I got from the board was you must put in public water.
That is true.
And where the public road goes, where the public water goes, is almost entirely ledge. Number one. Number two, the roadways had to be extended to service lots or actually be paid for by getting more lots. And they were not going to be private roads, they had to be public roads, which increased the expense by roughly three times. So the water line plus the public roads dramatically increased the expense of the infrastructure. The only way to pay for that expense was an increased density.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy.
Any other questions from members of the board? Dick?
Madam Chairman, a couple of comments that the attorney for the applicant had made to us. One was that in 10 days, I believe January 22nd in the correspondence, but 10 days, maybe the 26th, the Corps of Engineers will be on site. Have we notified our consultant, Normando, of that, and do they anticipate being there?
They've been notified, and I just verified today with the town manager that they're going to be asked to be there, and they've kind of planned on doing that, so we'd expect them there.
Okay. I had a question about the second comment that Mr. Frinsco made, suggestions that mapping await spring, which is a recommendation of our ecological consultant Normando, and also the neighbor's attorney through their consultants have made the same recommendation, and that ecological analysis, wetland evaluations can be conducted during the winter time. The question that is begged by that issue to me is whether or not the applicant has submitted a final wetland map that delineates all of the wetlands that they have found and are proposed on the site. And I'd like to hear yes to that question. If it is, it's about the third or fourth time that we've gotten a final map on wetlands submitted to the town.
Would you like to address that, Mr. Kennedy?
Yes. The wetlands, as you know, have been mapped by ecoanalysts. The discrepancy between the Normando report and the ecoanalyst report is over an opinion received from the Army Corps of Engineers in 1987, which ecoanalysts did, called Army Corps, got a verbal opinion, and the discrepancy in the area that I think, in fact, Dick, you and I walked it and looked at it on the first site walk, this is the 1.6 acres in question, it's wetlands. Ecoanalyst has suggested that we bring Army Corps out with Normando present and Ecoanalyst present. take a look at the site and see what Army Corps' present opinion of that site is, because as you know, the definitions have been changing and evolving over the last couple of years. We did not realize, I must say, at the inception of the Normando report, that it was a check on ECO. I was under the impression that Normando was going to do a wetland study, where, as the information I received from Steve Butler recently was, he wanted to make sure that ECO had done their study, flagged all the wetlands, and then Normando was going to review it. In fact, they bumped into each other on the site. Normando saw that ECO was there, so they left. Then they came back a second time, did some work, then it snowed, and they said they couldn't come back. Whereas I think we were led to believe that Normando was going to do their own report, independent of EcoAnalyst, whereas now I understand they were just going to check EcoAnalyst's work. So that's a question I have for you.
Okay, and that's an appropriate question. Back to my original question, though, Peter, for a moment. Have you submitted what you believe the wetlands for the site in map form as a final delineation of the wetlands on your land?
Yes. They've been flagged, mapped, and surveyed by Owen Haskell. Mm-hmm.
And your Corps of Engineers site visit will be to confirm or to change the mapped areas for wetlands on site?
That's correct. And to discuss this 1.6 acre area in here to see if they want to call that a wetland, with the Normando and ECO being present.
Okay, and you had asked us a question whether or not Normando is checking EcoAnalyst or whether they're doing their own independent evaluation.
Because I have seen no flagging of Normando.
Madam Chairman, to answer the question, I'm not sure where the breakdown happened, but I don't understand how the applicant would have thought that Normando was going to be doing starting from scratch. One, I don't think that was ever represented to the applicant. Secondly, it doesn't make any sense. In any time in the past when the planning board has hired a wetlands expert, they've all gone out and done a check of what the applicant's wetlands experts have shown to be the case on the field.
Anything My else? Comment to that is, when I asked Steve, whose definition are they going to use to map these wetlands? The answer was state of the art. Now that I would like to have defined at some point or other, because maybe Normando and ECO and the Army Corps would like to know what state of the art is.
We can pursue this back and forth.
Right. Maybe it's supposed to be state of Maine instead of state of the art.
You know, I mean, we're really running a little bit late. If we could get to some other questions, and we still have to address a wetlands alteration permit. Anyone else with questions? Ivan.
Yeah, Steve, I'd like to get back at this. I don't want to belabor the point, but is there a scope of work for Normando established?
Yes, there is.
And what is that? Is it a wetland study, or is it a review and check?
It's a review of the, I'm not sure what the exact language is. I believe it states it's a review of the language, review of the study that EcoAnalyst has done, as well as their own independent evaluation of what they think the wetlands conditions are. And that's where, I mean, so.
I guess my point would be, I'm a little concerned about this too, and I don't want to belabor the point, but I think Peter's raised a vital point here. I guess from a planning board's perspective on something as important as this, I would have liked to have seen the applicant's wetlands map established and an overlay established of our own consultants and compare the two. To me, that would have been a much better example of where we are at than having somebody go out and do the comparison, because sometimes you can be influenced one way or the other, even a professional in one way or another, because right. Some of this is gray. We're not going to be able to identify any of the gray areas, it doesn't seem, by the way it's being done now.
Well, I think,
or is that true?
I guess I would think that would not be true. I think that from what Normando has shown from their studies to date, They've identified one area, which seems to be the major area in question on the southerly site, where there's a big discrepancy. In addition, they've also said there are other areas where we've identified wetlands conditions where the applicant has it. And so I think that between all of that, and given the fact that the site isn't all that big, that I think that how the scope of work was laid out to Normando was that, you know, go out and evaluate, but see what's there. Starting from scratch, I don't think would serve any useful purpose, because they would probably have to do the same flagging, and on eight-tenths of the wetlands boundaries, they might agree.
So you're confident that with the work scope that our town consultant has right now, that we'll be able to identify the gray areas?
Right. So I think the wetlands, where the primary area of the wetlands are, except for a couple spots, are probably going to be the same. The question is going to be in terms of the boundaries, and are there some areas, some fingers of the wetlands identified or not identified by the applicant? And that's something Norman Doe, I think, would find. I mean, I think the neighbors, wetlands experts, have kind of done the same thing. They've said, here's where the wetlands are, and here's where we agree with the applicant's boundaries, and here's where we don't. So I think it's worked well in the past, and...
Mr. Kennedy, just go through the chair, please.
Madam Chair, can I ask this question?
Sure.
Steve Butler, could we then agree on a definition of wetlands?
Sure.
Could you state that definition, please?
I'm not Norman Doe Associates, and you're not eco-analyst.
But Norman Doe Associates is, I think, using a different definition than eco than the Army Corps of Engineers is. Are we not supposed to use the definition in the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance?
Originally, yes, and Peter, you were the one that disagreed with that and fought me every inch of the way on that issue, so then we decided that we let the wetlands experts decide what the definition would be, which would be state-of-the-art, be it Army Corps, what have you.
Let's agree on what it is going to be.
Why don't you two agree on that?
I don't think we can agree on that.
And, or discuss it later. And I'd like to get on to just a few things to address what was done the last time, and one of those was now in wetlands mapping there are always discrepancies. I can understand that. So now we have like three different wetlands reports on this.
We have five.
Five. I'm just a little concerned, and I would like to get it straightened out the next time, Mr. Kennedy, on the really the two traffic studies. If you recall, I asked Mr. Bray last time about some figures on traffic exiting Broad Cove. And he figured 50-50 with this brand new road. But included in your submission is indeed a report from Mr. Eaton, that is inconsistent with Mr. Bray's. So all I'm asking before the next time, please tell us what, if that report is invalid, please tell us that, and we will strike it. And you, if you don't want it to be included.
It was included for informational purposes before.
Yes, it was a wonderful.
Back in, I think it was 1987.
Right.
And I included just to show some of the history. And Mr. Bray's, as I think he pointed out last time, mm-hmm. conclusions pointed out some of the same things, but they used different methodology.
Yes, which is a conflict to me, you see. Mr. Eaton's report was done on 24 lots, et cetera. So I see that as some sort of a conflict. So if we could just straighten that out before the next time, it wouldn't take you long. And then, let's see, there was one other loose end that came to mind, and it had to do with, I don't know if it's a zoning issue or a legal issue. I don't know if it's the purview of the planning board. I don't know if it's a non-issue, but before these meetings, I read all of these ordinances, you know, because I haven't memorized them. And there is a very interesting ordinance here it's on page 31 of the zoning ordinance, and it has to do with corner lots. And it says, on a corner lot in any district, no fence, wall, hedge, etc., or other planting more than 3.5 feet in height shall be erected, placed, or maintained within the three-sided area formed by the intersecting street lines and a line joining them at points which lie 20 feet distant from the point of intersection measured along said street lines. Now, I think that that is a very good ordinance, and I think the way I interpret it, it was meant to create better sight lines. Now, in this re-subdivision that we haven't really addressed yet, it seems to me that 6 corner lots are being created. If they are being created, what do you do about the restrictions placed on those lots through these ordinances? It might be a non-issue. It's just that as I read it, 6 corner lots would be created.
We can take a look at it and see if it is an issue or a non-issue.
Just for the next
for sight distance within the right-of-way.
Well, no. I mean, I don't know when you created the two roads where lots used to be, if the people surrounding what was formerly lots, which will now be roads, purchased their homes as corner lots. And I don't know, it's a legal issue or it's a zoning issue, but it could become an issue that would be a problem later on, since I know nothing about it. I'm just bringing it up now because I think it would be helpful to you and to everyone involved. You know, I don't know about grandfathering, but it seems that when corner lots are created, our ordinance does restrict them. It's a small restriction, but, you know, and it could be a non-issue, but I would address it. Anything else before we get to the wetlands alteration permit? We still can discuss this next time and come to some conclusion, so do I hear a motion to table the preliminary plan so that we can go on to the wetlands alteration permit? Okay, do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay, now let's go on to the wetlands alteration permit. Steve, I will call on you to get us going on this.
Okay. I think that the things that are missing are fairly minor. That's why there are a lot of partials. Going through the checklist, which I believe the applicant has, they're required to provide slope contour lines at 1 foot intervals, and I didn't see those on the plan. Again, the areas of alteration were shown, but again, not quite the required 1 foot contours. The flow direction of all existing watercourses, ponds, and standing water, and all proposed drainage ditches, conduits, and watercourses, I don't believe was in the materials that were submitted with wetlands alteration. Again, I think that's pretty minor in terms of flow direction. The soils, types, and vegetative growth, I just flagged the point that it's been submitted, but the question in terms of regarding the fact Normando hasn't been able to go out and survey the whole site to their satisfaction is still an issue. Under the next item, which regards a statement indicating the anticipated effect, I think the period within which the proposed alteration will be made, there is no reference to a time frame within which the road work would be done. And that's it. Everything was either not applicable or seemed to be in order for completeness.
Okay. Any questions or comments? Mr. Decker, you would like to?
Yes, I'm Scott Decker from Squaw Bay Corp., and I'll attempt to address a couple of those issues anyway. The issue of the contours, early in the design process, in a conversation with Steve, we discussed some of the town's regulations in the ordinances, i.e. drawing sizes and items like that. And the comment that we received was that if these things are not deemed necessary and practical, that the board would waive those requirements. On this particular project, the contours that we have on the site are 2-foot contours. And yes, we could have interpolated between those contours and estimated what 1-foot contours would have been. It didn't seem to me to be practical. We've shown cross sections on the two major areas where the access road crosses the wetlands. We've shown in plan what the extent of the impact will be, and we've shown on the cross sections what the side slopes will be, and felt that the level of detail was adequate. Well, I guess I'll leave that at that. The flow directions, it was my understanding that these drawings were supplied to the planning board showing direction of flow arrows. Is that correct, Peter? So we feel as though that has been addressed. The time frame for constructing the roads, that is very difficult at this point in time to ascertain. We don't know at this point how much longer this process will take, and we can't start construction until we have the permits.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. Any questions or comments from members of the planning board?
Madam Chairman,
yes,
only on the application completeness, the issue of what constitutes a complete application is, again, to be debated perhaps or discussed. And the issue of a complete application is whether or not there's sufficient data on the application to show that the areas have been addressed as deemed required by ordinance and or if their provisions are waived by the planning board. Not to the accuracy, not attesting to the accuracy necessarily of the data. Again, the same issue that we faced before with the application completeness for preliminary plan submission. So I think in terms of whether data is presented or not becomes a critical issue, not trying to attest to the validity of that data.
Each one.
To the question of 1-foot contours, intervals, I think we need some briefing by staff on why or why not a 1-foot contour interval will be required, and we can determine tonight whether we are going to require a 1-foot contour or not. To the question of paragraph 3, where Steve has indicated a partial completion of that item based on certain data being submitted and certain data perhaps not being submitted. Mr. Decker has indicated that that data has been submitted, he believes, and so I'd like a response from Steve on that.
Okay.
1 foot versus 2 foot and then data completion.
1 foot versus 1 foot versus 2 foot contours as you read it here, is an absolute requirement unless it's weighed by the board. I think the difference would is usually looked for in terms of going to the 1 foot contour system when you have areas where the slope is relatively mild or the slope isn't all that great, so you can look and see how the water will drain or how the wetlands will be, you know, impacted in the final analysis. Whether or not there's some areas here where 1 foot, 2 foot, 2 foot contours, you know, might suffice, I don't know. I guess at this point I was looking at this primarily from going through and seeing what was there. I didn't see a request by the applicant for a waiver, so I just flagged it as being missing. In terms of flow direction, I do know from some of the information in the past that I do remember that for some of the drainage ditches, things of this nature, that there were some indications of flow direction. I didn't see it in the heavy or the thick packet of information that was here. I saw some of it, but not all of it. So I would say on that one, that flow direction is probably relatively minor and may have been shown elsewhere. one-foot contours, I think, is for the board to decide if it feels that it can.
Any other comments or questions?
Madam Chairman, on the one-foot, two-foot issue, if there were a discussion with the applicant at a previous stage, very often the planning board does not require on large subdivisions to have a one-foot contouring done, and that provision may or may not be waived, if it's even required to be waived during the application submission process. And I'm not sure how we've treated other wetland ordinance, wetland alterations previously on whether we required 1 foot or 2 foot.
I can't recall myself.
I think in the majority of cases we do ask for one-foot contours. In some cases where somebody has made the point that Mr. Decker raised and the board knew about it ahead of time. I think sometimes the board has said, yes, in this case, that makes sense. Other times they said, no, we still want the one-foot contours.
Now, in this case, we've got some fairly incised channels, as I remember walking through, and some of our planning board members getting wet up to the knees where no wetland showed. It wasn't a gradual slope. It was a fairly deep channel. Along the Farm Pond Road, it's a fairly sharp drop-off. There's only one area that I'm aware of that doesn't come sharply out of the wetlands, and that's the area in dispute. On whether or not it is a wetland, in fact. Mm-hmm. So maybe we have to hold that, although even in that case, on January 22nd, there's going to be a determination of where that wetland is by the Corps of Engineers, our consultant, and the applicant's consultant. So I'm not as concerned, I guess, by a 1 foot or 2 foot indication. If there's a fairly clear delineation of where the wetlands happen to be.
Mm-hmm. Does everyone agree, or do they disagree with Dick?
I agree.
You agree?
Madam Chairman?
Yeah. Steve?
They also seem to be asking for some type of variance on slope from 5-1 to 3-1. But I also agree that even with a 1 foot contour. If they went to the bother to put that on the map, I'm not sure that we'd gain a lot from looking at it. You know, what more do we see? You're only going to interpolate between the lines. We can do that visually also.
Good, Steve. Anything else?
Madam Chairman, yes. If the one-foot issue is not an issue of burning significance to this board versus the data that's provided, and if the applicant has testified, and as Steve has indicated, it's a minor issue whether or not flow directions are on. They are in some instances, and he didn't see them in every case. Are there any other issues that would prevent at least an application completeness determination so that we could begin to evaluate the technical merits of a wetland alteration permit application?
Steve?
I think none that I can see. I mean, that's a decision for the board to make.
Then do I hear a motion?
Chairman, I will make a motion of application completeness, but with a clear understanding that there are still substantial issues to resolve.
Resolve,
as
yes.
As we begin the technical review of the application, and perhaps the most significant being the difference between our consultant's determination of where wetlands are and the applicant's determination of wetlands,
right,
which is a significant issue.
Very.
To that end, I would move that we order that the application of the Greater Portland Development Group, Inc., for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for Highlands at Broad Cove, a proposed 20-lot subdivision located off Hunts Point Road, Farm Pond Road, Channel View Road, and Two Lights Road, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 19.3.9 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Well, the wetlands alteration has been deemed to be complete.
Madam Chairman, just so the board knows, then
Once that's done, then the board needs to advise the Conservation Commission, which I can do if the board so wishes. Then it also needs to set a public hearing on wetlands alteration. That's a February meeting. So you may want to incorporate that and either make it part of the motion, or another motion, or just advise
all
everybody
right,
that's the case.
Would you agree to make that part of the motion so we don't have to...
Or a separate motion that we have a public hearing at our February meeting date of February...
forget when it is.
20th.
February 20th?
At 7:05.
Thank you. Is there a second to that?
Seconded.
Okay. Any discussion?
Madam Chairman, only that we have the results of Normando's site visit with the Corps of Engineers and eco-analysts on site prior to that meeting.
Right.
Even if it's mailed.
Right. Because we certainly couldn't function properly without that.
And we really need it.
Madam Chairman, quick question.
Yes.
The board surely going to meet on the 20th of February.
Well, Steve says so. I don't have my calendar.
Is that the vacation week for children? Yeah. It may
Your
be.
Your practice has been, I think.
Well, sometimes we have altered that. I don't know how many are.
How, are any of you going away on vacation? You'll be away.
I'll be there.
I'll be here.
I'll be here.
I'll be here.
Okay, we will go on with that.
We'll have the hearing.
Yeah. Okay, any more discussion? I think we have to come to a vote on that. Hearing no more discussion, all in favor of Dick's last motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And one more thing. You did hear, since you were unable to attend the Conservation Commission meeting, you did hear the report from the Conservation Commission, and I think that they're still here. Do you have any questions to ask of them before we close on this project this evening?
I'd like a copy of the report, and I apologize, Sally, for not making a meeting, but the plane was 3 hours late. So
I knew
at 10 o'clock at night, I didn't think they were still meeting.
Right.
But no, if I have a copy of the report, and then I will talk to Sally or whomever and
okay,
see if we can work out.
Are there any other comments from the Conservation Commission regarding this at this time? Okay, if not, we thank you very much. We thank the public for their input. This has certainly been very fruitful, and it certainly is democracy in action. And it's nice to see everyone exercising constitutional rights. So we thank all of you, and does the Planning Board wish to take a short break before we go on to the next? We're very sorry that we've gone over time, but we will address Mr. Balfour in about 5 minutes. Is that all right? Thank you. We'll be back. I'm glad you told me because...
use planted in it, and you go across the street, and as you come up it, it seems like I didn't want to create what I call spite fencing, or the look of spite fencing. I wanted a more open look of it flowing from one property line to the property to the next, and that I felt the open grassed area created that instead of created that each thing looked different. So it's an aesthetic issue, and it's one that I just made the judgment call that it was consistent with the area to have the lawns blend together, and I think it will look better that way. And there, that's it.
My own preference would be
the opposite, just because I think that we've made some mistakes there. I think we made a horrible mistake allowing that ledge to be removed by the dry cleaner that didn't last as a dry cleaner very long. And I think we get some scars there, and to me, anything that we can put back would be an improvement. So I just toss out to the rest of the board, if it were me alone making the decision, I'd want to see some low shrubs. I think your point is a good one. You certainly don't want to look like you're trying to block off the guy next to you, but just something that appears natural and attractive rather than just what is a relatively unattractive side of that building. And that's not your fault, but it isn't particularly good to look at. And as you come around the corner, you just see that side. I'd rather see something. I don't think we're talking about a big cost issue. If we're talking, you know, four or five low plants, evergreens. So my preference would be to do that. I toss it out for the rest of the board. I'm not going to fight to the death over it, but I'd like to just get the sense of the rest of the board on that.
Madam Chairman, yes. I do think that perhaps that is a matter of personal taste, and I think that the sketch that's been submitted has added so much beautification to it that in my mind, nothing further really needs to be done in that order, and I, for one, would feel that it's fine the way it is.
Yes, when Mr. Hennessy came forward the last time, would have been the time to have that done.
He just said, back in your place?
Well, I think Mr. Hennessy came in a year or so ago, was it not, over the construction of the garage. And the nice doctor went in there, and yeah, we must have been remiss because actually the shrubs could have been on your property, right, behind there. Don't you have room to put some shrubs?
He doesn't want to get dragged into
No,
this.
I know. But I think that's where we missed the boat on that.
Yeah. I said, I'm not going to fight to the death over it. I'd make you do it, but I'm not going to scream and yell.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
I might just add that although it doesn't show in the rendering here, which I also think is very nice, the sign will be moved back from the street and actually partially cover part of that building. Not that that's a great way to hide the building, but it also does.
Well, the kids' room right by the stop sign on the wall.
That will satisfy them.
It pulls it back, the sign back from the road, which will be an improvement, I think.
Mistake.
I'd like to request the town straighten out the stop sign, because it is truly crooked like that.
And
that's part of the character of the town. We wouldn't want to do that.
On the issue of the snow removal, I personally feel, I don't speak for the rest of the board, that snow removal is something that would be between you and the staff. I don't think that snow removal is the purview of the planning board, but if the rest of you have different feelings. Any other comments? Then if none, yes?
Again, to raise another issue that was in my memo, at least, regarding the striping of the parking lot. I just wanted to get a sense of the board so we know, in terms of suggested motion, which items to punk off or add on. It's an issue. It's there. Parking's tight. The other thing that originally raised that issue in my mind was the fact that it was right in the Zoning Board of Appeals minutes. But it's up to you as a board
to decide. Was it in the minutes?
To decide whether or not you think it's required for the site.
What does the board feel about the striping?
Well, I think we've got a suggested motion with some conditions that are directed in that direction, aren't they, Steve?
Yeah. I just want to see in terms of if I'm asked to read it, for instance, which ones should be added or deleted. I mean, Mr. Balfour suggested perhaps adding one regarding the size of the planting of the yews. I mean, that's another one that could be added that's not here now.
Any comments?
I would make a motion.
Sure.
Okay. Be it ordered that the request of Century 21 Balfour, Scott Balfour, for site plan approval for an office building addition located at 295 Ocean House Road be granted according to Section 19-2-9 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. A, that the entire site shall be developed and maintained as depicted on the presented site plan, except as amended by these conditions of approval. Approval of the planning board shall be required for any alteration to or deviation from the approved site plan. B, that the landscaping improvements contained in the applicant's approved site plan shall be completed by the applicant and approved by the building inspector by June 1st, 1990. Said improvements are not completed and approved by said date, then the site plan approval shall become null and void. C, that the parking spaces depicted on the approved site plan shall be delineated by striped lines to be painted on the pavement surface, with this striping to be maintained and repainted as needed. Said striping shall be completed by the applicant and approved by Public Works Director and Town Planner by June 1st, 1990. Such striping is not completed and approved by said date, then the site plan approval shall once again become null and void. D, that the requirements of this approval and the above aforementioned conditions shall be binding upon the present and future owners of the affected lots. And E, that a covenant incorporating the above mentioned conditions shall be inserted into the deed of the property, deed of this property. Said covenant shall be submitted by the applicant for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner, and then recorded by the applicant with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds within 90 days of the granting of this public access waiver. And I might add, this is probably bigger than the whole project.
I know it. Is there a second? A second to this?
Second.
Okay, Steve. Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none.
Wait a minute. I think we've got a problem here.
What is it?
On E, I've read it, but I didn't read it. We're not talking about a public access waiver, are we, Steve?
No.
All right. Why do we say here? Then recorded by the applicant with the Cumberland County authorities within 9 days of the granting of this public access waiver.
Oh, shoot. Right.
So I would modify that to just...
I didn't think I could hear you, but now I did hear you.
Yeah.
And it shouldn't have been.
Site plan.
Well, I didn't hear it. Judy heard
it. Site plan approval. Good.
Site plan. With granting of this site plan approval. So I would modify condition E to read that a covenant incorporating the above-mentioned condition shall be inserted into the deed of this property. Said covenant shall be submitted by the applicant for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner, and recorded by the applicant with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds within 90 days of the granting of this site plan approval.
Okay, good. Good catch, my word.
Well, I don't take credit for it.
You'll have to excuse us, but Steve has been very ill. He's delirious.
You also can see where I got that provision from.
That's right. Do you mind, Steve, seconding what the change that he has just made?
We were just talking
you
about
agree?
That, but I guess I don't agree.
Yeah. Okay. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor of the motion made by Ivan, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Good luck.
Why, thank you.
Oh, and one abstention. Right. Mr. Tinsman, he wants that on the record. Nice working with you, Mr. Balfour, and we certainly wish you well. Thank you.
Good luck with anything.
Thank you. Next on the agenda, Rick Weinschenk for a three-lot minor subdivision. Haven't seen you in a while, Mr. Weinschenk.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Great.
As you said, I'm here for a three-lot minor subdivision located on a 16-acre piece of property between Old Ocean House Road and Route 77. I would like to clear up three little bits of misinformation that I passed on 2 months ago when I was here, and by the map which I submitted. The first and most important is the location of the painted ledge out on Route 77 is in fact not on this property. As I was first walking through the northerly border, I picked up on someone else's red flags and ended up a few hundred feet away from where I thought I was, land I thought I was buying. Secondly, on the map which has been submitted, there is indicated a proposed pedestrian easement. It's been mislabeled to be 5 feet. It should say 10 feet. It's drawn 10 feet. And on the easterly side, the Old Ocean House side, the lot line labeled 246 feet would be divided by this proposal into 100 feet and 146 feet. That just was not clear on the plan.
Could you clarify that? Where was it?
Where we have shown the driveway, a driveway coming out onto Old Ocean House Road.
Yeah.
That should have, that boundary line should have been divided into 146 feet on the lot, the southerly lot, and 100 feet on the northerly lot. Instead, it just reads 246 across the whole length of that.
Are you going to fix all this for the next
year? Yeah.
Right.
Final plan to be signed, I hope.
Now, have you been, are you in receipt, or have you been in receipt of the December 11th letter from the town engineer citing various things?
The checklist, you mean?
No.
No.
I have in my possession, I'm sure you must have, from the town engineer, Robert E. Hunter, a letter dated December 11th regarding his comments on your subdivision.
Rick may not.
No, I do not have it, nor have I seen it.
Could you, or else tell Mr. Weinschenk, you know, at this point, and then we can give him a copy later, exactly what some of the
I think they're relatively, I mean, there's several that are in there. One talks about a defined right-of-way for the common access drive for lot 18-2. That, you know, you have a shared driveway, but you don't talk about how that's really going to be allocated between the two properties. Talks about the survey information having been taken from a 1970 survey, and that some things aren't there in terms of the level of detail that you would normally would see. And I think that those are some of the things that you refer to in your letter. They talk about soils, and the state said it's hard to tell what the drainage is going to be without contour lines being shown. It mentions the fact that there's information for the subsurface septic system for lot 18-1, but not for lot 18-2. And I think that that's those are the major issues.
So that will help you for the next time.
Yeah, that would be big
then
help.
Then you can change the map and fix all of that.
I'll just address two of those, if you don't mind, just to get your feeling on it. The driveway that I've shown in here and proposed, I would not like to have be a requirement of this subdivision, in so much as I have a customer who is willing to buy one half of this proposed subdivision, or all of it if the subdivision should be denied. That person is willing and would happily share a driveway with a neighbor, and most importantly, I suppose, split the cost of plowing this very long driveway. Not in having an idea who the other person may be, that person may, like the other homes on that section of Old Ocean House Road, very much like to have their own driveway, and not knowing that person again, we have not pursued and don't want to pursue, if we don't have to pursue, locating, doing tests, and designing a septic system for that lot. We feel that it would be more appropriate to first know whether that was to be designed for a two-bedroom home or a 12-bedroom home, for example. But would be more than happy to accept the condition that no construction begin on that lot until it goes through the normal channels, which it would anyway, which would be to have a septic system designed for it. And I guess that takes care of two of those items, or at least my comments on them, and I would like it possible to get some expression back from the board.
Steve, perhaps you could address quickly just some of the things
on completeness.
On the completeness issue.
Some of which have already been touched
addressing.
Upon.
Yeah.
Steve,
anything that
Steve,
hasn't
before
been
you get into that, I looked at a lot of plans, Mr. Weinchick, but I tell you, I'm having a real hard time on this plan here. I think I've figured out where Lot 18-2 is, but there's some lines on this plan that frankly confuse the living daylights out of me. It might be worthwhile to, at least I'm one planning board member having a hard time understanding the plan, to go through it a little bit, even if it's complete or incomplete. There's a line that seems to go through the middle of 18-2, a solid line. I assume that the dashed lines, I guess only the dashed line is the outline of the lot. Is that correct?
The solid line separates the soil type.
So
and I understand what you're saying, and I guess
soil
I...
Soil type?
Yeah, you see Hollis D right above that solid line. To the left of the labeling lot 18-2, 9 plus or minus acres.
Okay, so am I to understand that solid lines then are separating soil types throughout here? Or I guess the plan is not up to the usual quality that we usually see on these plans, so I'm having a real hard time with it. Just an editorial comment.
It needs a key, is what it needs.
It needs a key or it needs something.
There's a legend in the bottom right-hand corner that shows the solid line as the soil boundary and the dashed line as the map supplement, the soil map supplemented by actual field survey. It's no question, it's a little confusing. I'd be happy to submit to you next time two or three maps trying to deal with this minor subdivision in as little paperwork as possible.
Yeah,
apparently
I understand
it's
that.
Not work.
I'm just saying from my perspective, it's taken me a long time to figure out exactly where we are on this thing. I'm sorry, Steve, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Well, that's fine. I think that you'll see there are a lot of things that normally one would expect, and even a minor subdivision plan which aren't here, some of which have been addressed by the applicant. Parks and going down to everything's okay down to 4B, parks and public space, there is a requirement in the ordinance that states that up to 10%. May be dedicated for recreation space. He has shown a green belt area, but nothing more. Lot line data survey, I guess 7, 8.
Steve, can I ask a question on that?
Sure.
10%. Dick and I were talking about that before, and it's nothing that we seem to seize on automatically, but it's in the ordinance, and it talks about shall provide 10% or give us some money.
Right.
Are you suggesting here that there be an area set aside of 10%?
Yeah. I'd say either an area set aside or some discussion about the money payment in lieu of. There's just been no discussion about that.
Because we haven't been discussing that in previous subdivision applications as formally. Sometimes developers allow some land and then we fight over whether it's wetlands or not.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's something we need to focus on more.
I think on Highlands it was discussed and a couple others. I think you have to remember that the board's dealing with what's a relatively new subdivision ordinance. It isn't, but in terms of its use, there were a lot of subdivisions that were still being coming under the old subdivision standards. So you've only probably had four or five subdivisions under the new ordinance. That's something that the public space boundaries is a completeness issue, but it's also a substantive criteria item. That once somebody has completeness, then the board then has to go to Article 2 of the subdivision ordinance and go through, well, actually Article 3, and one of the general standards talks about things such as donations to the green belt.
Well, I understand 10%. That if the requirement, though, is 10%,
up to
10%, then don't we need to have the developer affirmatively tell us what they propose to do there? And I guess I didn't see anything here on that.
Where?
Unless, right. Is it the That doesn't include easements, does it?
Well, it can.
It's supposed to be public recreation.
Usually it's supposed to be public recreation. Sometimes the board has combined both Greenbelt contributions and public open space. I put a question mark.
Where's our 10%?
You don't get 10%. No. What I proposed was to was that pedestrian easement, which represents roughly 3% of the total land area, and in so much as that